So, welcome to another video. Today is a good day because I received a package I've been waiting for since November 2020. As you may know, I've wanted to upgrade the suspension of my 2008 Saab 93 Sports Estate for some time now, and in November I actually ordered Eibach Springs and Bilstein B8s. Had to wait a long time by no fault of the store where I bought them. I bought them at Neo Brothers. They were very communicative. They told me that there was this huge backlog due to the whole COVID situation. And because I couldn't get them anyway, I decided to have the patience to just wait and see. And now is the day that they arrived. So let's start with the unboxing. I know it doesn't look like it. It's incredibly hot here, so it's hard to be super excited, but I'm actually genuinely super excited with the fact that they are finally here. So what do we have? One, two, whoa, three, and four. So look at that. Sportwagen zum Einbauen. Okay. So let's see what's inside and if they are actually the right models. So this is it then. And they are quite a lot beefier than they look on the photos. So yeah, let's just unpack them all and put them on the table. Fairly happy to see that there are actually dust boots on the rear shock absorbers, because it wasn't clear on the pictures if they were included, yes or no. For the front, I do have the actual original dust boots that should be able to fit on them. But basically, we can put these aside until we are able to mount them, because there is no preparation work or anything that we have to do with this. And then let's get all the other stuff that we need to actually assemble the entire assembly. Let's get it on the table. And here's everything we need. So a spring, a coil sleeve, I suppose they are called, for some additional protection. The dust boot, the spinny thing, and of course the top mount. And of course, we'll have to compress these. And that's slightly unnerving because I've never done that before. And I did actually look at a lot of other YouTube videos to see how it's supposed to work. I also bought a kit that seems to be fairly secure. Didn't buy the absolute cheapest kit I could find. There we are. Look, so it has these locking pins, which should theoretically hold the springs in place. We'll see. So let's get started. First, it helps quite a bit if you have a surface where you can keep the entire thing level. So basically, I'm sort of clamping it on a workmate. Next, remove the top nut and the washer. So basically, you need to make sure there's this indentation in there where the end of the spring should sit. Now the next task is to compress the spring. If you do this at home, please be incredibly careful, because you are putting a lot of pressure or compression on the spring. So be sure to use the security pins that are on there. Those will help quite a bit, but also be careful. They're on there. And here you already see one of the problems, is that this bar is basically cleared by the fact that there's this indentation here. But on the other side, it doesn't work like that. So what you see is that it already damages the paint quite a bit. Ideally, you would have the compressors that where the entire rod is situated a little bit farther from the actual spring. I don't have those, so I'm going to accept a slight bit of paint damage in exchange for the security of knowing that this actually works and that it's actually secure. The advantage of this spring compressor is that there's actually this square hole in here, so you can put this one on there. And as you can see, I basically give it around 6 rotations on one side, then on the other side, then one side. You don't want to go all the way on one side and then on the other side, because then you have the chance of the spring basically flipping out of the entire compressor. Thank you. basically we're already quite close to where we can create the entire assembly, and you can quickly see that if you grab the top bearing, you put it on there, and then the top mount. I'm still ways off, like a few centimeters, so I will continue this work. Dust boot, bearing, top mount, washer, and the nut, top nut. It's a 22 millimeter, which we will put on hand tight for now to make sure we're not actually cross threading. It's on. The problem we have right now is that tightening the top knot is actually quite difficult, because as soon as you put this on there and you start tightening it, the whole rod of the strut will just turn as well. So you have to sort of counteract that movement. So as you can see here, there's this 6 millimeter Allen key that you can put on there. So basically, this allows you to stop the rod from turning. The problem is that this makes it incredibly difficult to tighten the nut, of course. So what you basically want to do is use an open-ended ratchet so that you can sort of put this on there and the open-ended ratchet on top of it, and then the Allen key can go through there. I don't have that. The secondary option is there are specialized tools. I found them on Bimmer Forum, for example. So my BMW owner friends might have one of those, but I don't have one of those either. So what I'm going to do is do it the DIY way. So I'm going to put this on there. I'm going to put this one in there. And I'm going to use one of these to actually tighten. So finally, it's in. And to be honest, if I were to do this again, I'd probably buy a better tool. It's extraordinarily hard to get a good grip on this one. So it was super hard. It took a long time, but it's in. There's no play. So it should be okay. And again, be sure to undo them bit by bit on both sides to prevent one side from being completely loose, the other completely tight, and the spring just snapping out of the compressor, basically. Now it's time to pack all the things we need for installation, so we can bring it to the DIY garage. And it's quite a lot of stuff. We have the front shocks fully assembled and the rear shocks, springs and mounts. We're also bringing new tie rod ends that we'll install separately. Then tools. A breaker bar and a set of torque wrenches. A hammer, Allen keys, an adjustable wrench and a pliers wrench. And we're also taking a full set of sockets, including an e-torque set that we'll be needing a lot. We'll also bring the spring compressors and a brand new pass-through socket set. Now, let's get everything packed and ready to go. Finally, it's installation day. I got help from two mates and we rented the car lift to make life easier. We'll start by removing the wheels, by loosening the bolts with a breaker bar and then removing them entirely once the car is on the lift. Now that all the bolts that will be removed are visible, we can clean them up a bit and spray them with some WD-40 penetrating fluid to get the bolts out a bit easier later on. First, we'll detach the sway bar and links from the shock absorber using a 17 mm open-ended wrench between the rubber boot and the back of the mounting point so the threaded lock doesn't spin. Now just put the sway bar aside. The next step is removing the wheel speed sensor and brake hose from the bracket on the shock. The brake hose is held in place with a retaining clip that can be pulled out using a plier. The wheel speed sensor is on a small bracket that's held in place by a 10 mm bolt.
Now it's time for the heavy work of removing the shock. It's mounted to the steering knuckle using two spline bolts, which means that once we get the nuts off with a breaker bar, we need to push the bolts out rather than unscrew them. And we did that by leaving the nuts on the end and hitting them with a hammer. This probably isn't the recommended way of doing this, but it worked. Now we can force the steering knuckle out of the shock using brute force or a screwdriver or small crowbar. The shock is now held in place only by the three top bolts, which you can see and access once you pop the hood. And as you can see, I have a strut bar mounted, an upgrade I can heartily recommend. The effect of this modification might become even more noticeable with the new shocks. Remove the three bolts using either a hexagon socket or a Torx E socket depending on the bolts you have. Be sure to hold the shock on the bottom, because as soon as the three bolts are out, the shock will just fall on the ground. Now that the shock is out, we can compare old and new and see the difference in height. The Bilstein B8 combined with the Eibach lowering springs will make the car sit around 3 cm or a bit over an inch lower, which should improve looks quite a bit. Now position a new, already assembled shock in its mounting position. Make sure you grab the correct one, as the brackets and orientation are different for each side. Also check the top bolt mounting positions before you hold the heavy shock in place, as they are not in a perfect triangle. Two of them are closer to each other than to the other one. Once you torque the top bolts down, you can easily turn the shock so that the mounting points on the bottom are once again correctly aligned. The next step is to reattach the steering knuckle to the shock. Lining up the bolt holes can be a bit finicky. Again, supporting the weight of the steering knuckle will help you get it lined up perfectly, which should make reinserting the bolt easy. Now you can torque the nuts down to 80 Nm. And after that, rotate them for an additional 135 degrees. This puts stress on the bolt, which is by design, but this also means it's not recommended to reuse these bolts. I did and often see it done on YouTube, but buying new ones is the preferred way. Now that the shock is back in and mounted to the top mount as well as the steering knuckle, we can reattach the wheel speed sensor bracket using the 10 mm bolt and put the brake hose in the right place and reinsert the retaining clip. Now we either reinstall the sway bar end link or detach it from the sway bar and replace it with a new one. We did the latter, but unfortunately didn't film it. The process, however, is the same as on the other side. Use a 17 mm spanner to counter hold and unscrew the nut, and then just reinstall the new sway bar end link and torque both nuts down to 64 Nm. Having remounted the end links, having repeated the entire process on the other side, and having triple checked all bolts and nuts means we successfully overhauled the front suspension. A cup of coffee and some sandwiches provide for some much needed sustenance and energy for the next part of the job.
Now let's focus on the back. To get the spring out, we'll have to disconnect the cross stay from the spindle housing, which means the spring could pop out. It should be fine as there is not a lot of stress on the spring, but to be safe, we'll support the cross stay with a tall jack stand. You can also lower the car and support the cross stay from below using a jack.
Now, let's start with unscrewing the Torx E bolt that connects the shock to the spindle housing. It's either an 18 or a 20. A breaker bar helps with loosening the bolt, after which a ratchet should be fine.
We will be using new mounts, so we can just remove shock and mount from the chassis. If you do reuse the old mounts, you could leave those on and instead disconnect the top bolt holding the shock to the mount. Be aware that you have to counter hold the rod to prevent it from spinning. It depends on the current shock how to do this, but it will most likely work by putting a 6 mm Allen key in the rod or a 7 mm socket over the rod while using an open-ended wrench to undo the nut and put a new one in reverse. I bought new mounts because the old ones apparently can break. It turns out they were still fine, but as I had fresh ones, I decided to use those anyway. I combined the mount and the shock outside of the car, which makes it a bit harder to align the bottom of the shock to the spindle housing later on, but we got lucky, as you'll see further in this video.
Now reinstall shock and mount using the three bolts, torquing them down to the specified 53 Nm. We won't reconnect the bottom bolt at this moment, but rather we'll first focus on getting the spring replaced. The recommended way of doing this is with a spring compressor, but as mine didn't fit the tight working space, we went with an alternate method. First, we'll disconnect the cross stay from the spindle housing, using a breaker bar to loosen the nut, and then remove the bolt. Now we elevate the lift, so that we can pull down the cross stay. If you use the jack for this step, just lower the jack. Now you can remove the entire spring, including the rubber mounting points on top and bottom. Be careful here, the spring has some tension and will pop out with some force. Nothing too dangerous, just make sure your hands are not in the way. We'll be replacing the top and bottom mounts as well, and I recommend doing this, as the additional cost is low compared to the shocks and springs. I added the bottom one, which functions as a mounting point as well as a bump stop, at home already. I used some silicone spray to make this easier.
Okay, we need to talk a little bit about what just happened here, because if you look at the slow-mo of this clip, you'll see that we accidentally disconnected the headlight level sensor. It's a small rod with two rubber grommets basically on two knobs, and it just snapped out of place here. I was lucky enough to catch it when editing the video, and since we've been able to basically put it back in its place, no damage done. But if you have xenon headlights and you're replacing the springs, just disconnect the rod for a little bit, just pull on it and it should be fine, and you can reconnect it once you're done, and no damage will be done to the headlight level sensor, which is quite an expensive part if you break it. So with that advice, back to the video.
Now we can reinstall the spring in the correct location. As you can see, the spring sits a bit crooked, something that will correct itself when the cross stay is back in its correct position. This is where we reattach the shock to the spindle housing, with the torque wrench set at 150 Nm, because we saw that the bolt holes on the shock and spindle housing lined up perfectly. If it doesn't, you can save this step for later when you reattach the cross stay, as you'll be adjusting the position of the suspension there to remount the cross stay anyway. Now we use a jack stand to support the cross stay while lowering the lift, adjusting it slightly so it lines up perfectly. If you use the car jack, which is probably the safe way, just raise it for the same effect. Keep an eye on the spring. It should start to seat itself correctly as the cross stay is getting closer to the spindle housing. Now reinsert the bolt and torque the nut down to 75 Nm. And after that, add an additional 90 degrees of rotation. Also make sure you did not forget to tighten the upper shock mounting nut. Now we're all done and we can reattach all wheels, torquing them down to 110 Nm once they are on the ground. I'm beyond stoked with the end result. It sits noticeably lower, but the ride is still comfortable. Sturdier, yes, but that's more than made up for with the massively improved handling and stability. A recommended upgrade. Thanks for watching and see you on the next video.